Thank you, Donald, and good evening, everybody. Well, last night, hundreds of Jewish people protested in Parliament Square, carrying banners saying, enough is enough, and their protest was aimed fairly and squarely at Jeremy Corbyn, the leader of the Labour Party. The claims are that he's turned a blind eye to growing anti-Semitism within the party. And today, within the last hour, we've heard that Labour MP for Barrow-in-Furness, John Woodcock, has said he's considering resigning the Labour whip, and that would mean him sitting in the House of Commons as an independent, and he's doing it over claims of anti-Semitism within the party, plus he's also very critical of Corbyn's stance on Russia. So is anti-Semitism on the rise in this country, and indeed across the rest of Europe too? Or is it all a big right-wing conspiracy cooked up by the newspapers who were trying to do down Jeremy, given that he's doing pretty well in the polls, and hey, he's doing pretty well amongst the youth of this country? And interestingly, it's the Daily Mail that have absolutely led the charge. Front page, enough is enough, Mr. Corbyn. Front page, anti-Semitic Labour, the stench grows. Exclusive, Corbyn's son allowed a Nazi cartoon showing an arm marked with the Star of David crushing people to remain on his Facebook profile. Words are not enough. Jewish groups demand Corbyn acts against rampant anti-Semitism in the Labour Party. Revealed, Corbyn deluged by 74 allegations of shocking anti-Semitism that would make a committed neo-Nazi blush, and I could go on. It is indeed the Daily Mail that have led this charge against Corbyn and the Labour Party of anti-Semitism. Is this being done for purely political reasons, or are the Daily Mail legitimate and correct and right in their concerns? I want to know what you think. If you think anti-Semitism actually is on the rise in this country and has, frankly, been allowed to grow within the Labour Party, then call me on 0345 6060973. Maybe you think actually the problem's far bigger and it isn't just happening in this country, it's happening across the rest of Europe too, and it's very worrying. Then please text to 84850. Or if you think actually this is unfair, it is wrong, and it's about time, the Daily Mail and others were called out for foul play, well, then you can tweet using the hashtag Farage and LBC, at LBC, and of course, you can watch us live on Facebook, and you can comment there too. My own observation of this is, firstly, it's interesting to see another party leader being accused of terrible things. If I'd ever, in my time as leader of UKIP, had senior party figures making some of the comments that have been made by some Corbyn-stroke-Labour supporters, then the headlines about me wouldn't have just appeared in the Daily Mail, they would have appeared absolutely everywhere. But I do think there's been a growth of anti-Semitism, not just in this country, but right across the whole of Europe too. I can tell you, numbers of times I've walked in to the European Parliament in Strasbourg early in the morning, and Strasbourg has the biggest Jewish population of any city in France. And I see in a Jewish district, which is not very far away from the Parliament, children going into school, sort of 8-ish in the morning, and there are armed guards making sure the kids are going into school safely. Why? Because there have been attacks in the street, stabbings, etc., against Jewish people that have taken place in Strasbourg. And friends of mine that live in Brussels say that you only stay in Brussels now if you're a Jewish person, if you're wealthy enough to live in a gated community and to be safe. And the evidence, folks, is that actually Jewish people are leaving Brussels and leaving Paris, heading for Israel and elsewhere. So I think this is not just about Jeremy Corbyn's Labour Party. I think it's a much bigger problem. And it's pretty remarkable that less than three quarters of a century after the end of the Second World War that this is happening. So I think the Labour Party does have a problem. I'm not even sure Corbyn recognises what this problem is. That is my view, but let's please, because it's LBC, hear yours. Going to ask Clive in Twickenham what he makes of all of this. Good evening.
Good evening, Nathan. I think that Sir Jeremy Corbyn is quite wise enough to know exactly who and what people think in his party. If there are any people against the Jewish people, and there may be one or two, because you get them in every sort of hating the English, hating the Scots, hating the Welsh.
Yes, I mean, Clive, that's certainly true. You will get prejudice of all kinds in any walk of life, and I understand that completely. But wasn't it interesting when Corbyn himself, when he was talking about this, said there were pockets of anti-Semitism within the Labour Party? Huh? That suggests to me, Clive, that it's more than the odd person here and there.
Right, pockets. Well, how about this Conservative Party? Aren't there pockets of right-wing anti-Jewish people in there?
Well, I don't doubt that's the case, Clive, and I think you'd find that in every walk of life. But can I just tell you that when I was leading a party that was coming up and challenging the establishment, and when these sort of allegations were made against my party and my party membership and officers and local councillors or whatever it may be, if ever I found any genuine evidence that was true, I actually got rid of them. And it seemed to me, Clive, maybe you think I'm wrong, but in 2016, you know, Shami Chakrabarti was asked to carry out an independent inquiry into the issue. But when she published her report, basically the whole thing was a whitewash. She said that the party was not overrun by anti-Semitism, Islamophobia, or any other form of racism. And very shortly thereafter, she went to the House of Lords.
Well, Jeremy Corbyn will be looking into what's going on in the Labour Party. He will be having talks, you can guarantee that. And we're waiting to see what comes of all this. The Daily Mail, the Tiny Hammer, the Labour Party, because they know they're got a good chance of winning the next election, which I hope they do. Mm-hmm. And Jeremy Corbyn, to me, doesn't seem that sort of person that dislikes anybody, be quite honest much. He's, yes, you can laugh, I don't think so.
I wasn't laughing, Clive.
That was a sharp intake
of breath, as opposed to laughing.
Well,
what I was going to say, Clive, was he does have some odd friends, doesn't he?
He does, yes.
I mean, taking Gerry Adams and Martin McGuinness into the House of Commons not long after the Brighton bomb, describing Hamas and Hezbollah as friends. Odd choices, Clive.
Maybe. But then they're blaming Livingstone, and that was all blown up out of all proportion.
All right. So, Clive, you are a Corbynista.
I say this. I think the Jewish people should thank us for what we did in the last war. Have they ever?
This is getting very interesting. Now, Clive, Jewish people shouldn't just thank us for what happened from the sort of late 1930s through. They should also thank us in many ways for what happened in the early parts of the 20th century when very many came from Russia to the East End of London.
That's right.
And you know something, Clive?
Yes.
From what I can see, I think the Jewish communities in this country, who, by the way, are tiny, we get this impression there are large numbers of Jewish people in Britain. There aren't.
No.
There are about 300,000. My impression, Clive, is they have been eternally grateful to us and a very successful migrant group who've integrated and done incredibly well.
Yes, they have. And, I was going to say, so they should, in a way. A lot of the young men were killed keeping this country free. If we had been taken over in 1940, where would we be today? The whole of Europe would be run by the Nazis.
That, Clive, is certainly true, and I can tell you that on Saturday of this week, on the eve of the 100th anniversary of the Royal Air Force, I will be interviewing, I'm going to be meeting and interviewing two of the airmen who flew in the Battle of Britain, and I will play those interviews here on Sunday morning.
There's not many left, is there?
There's about seven or eight left who actually qualify as being among the few. Clive, I totally agree with you. Had it not been for fewer than 3,000 British airmen, we wouldn't even be having this conversation because we wouldn't be allowed to. Clive, I understand your point of view. I don't agree with it, but that is LBC, and I thank you very much indeed for your call. Steve says on Facebook, there will be no Jews left in the UK in a few years. Steve, I talked about Jewish people leaving Paris and leaving Brussels. I get a sense, and please people ring me up and tell me I've got this right or wrong, I get a sense that in some of the Jewish parts of North London, where people aren't wealthy and don't live in gated compounds, there is some increasing concern about their safety living in those neighbourhoods. I'm going to go quickly to Anthony, who called in from Ash in Surrey. Good evening, Anthony.
Hello.
You're a new caller. What motivated you to call me, Anthony?
It's just the impression that I thought you were giving to start with, that you were leaning against the mail and the way it's presented.
No, I'm not, Anthony. I'm trying to present a debate, and clearly there are some, Anthony, and the last caller I had thinks the Daily Mail are cooking it up, Jeremy Corbyn's a reasonable guy, and there isn't really a problem. Anthony, my view is there is a very real problem, and let me tell you what I think it is. This has a lot to do with politics. I talked about the size of a Jewish community in this country. It is relatively small. The Muslim community in this country is 10 times, if not more, that size. And I think, politically, the Labour Party are hoovering up the Muslim vote in a most remarkable way, and that has allowed voices within the Labour Party to say things that are frankly not acceptable.
No, I agree with that. And the thing is that I'm afraid, in the case of Jeremy Corbyn, he's totally Mr. Teflon. It doesn't matter what he says, what he does, it just washes off him.
Do you really think, Anthony, that a charge, some of the charges that are being made, and the fact they're not going away, don't you think for the first time this could just begin to damage him?
No, I don't. Because people, like your last caller, how the hell do you get round that?
Anthony, you'll always get some that are committed to any particular leader or ideology, but it's the fair-minded people, Anthony, sitting in the middle. It's the swing voters, and I think they may be affected by this.
Well, that's the difference. Swing voters, me, the last guy, it really does get me very, very worried.
Mm.
We are pursuing this sort of agenda, or it seems to, against a very, very small group of people in this country.
Yep. And that's why, of course, in electoral terms, they're not particularly important. Anthony, I thank you for your call, your point of view. You're listening to the Nigel Farage Show. Is anti-Semitism on the rise in modern-day Britain, indeed across the rest of Europe too, or is this all total unfairness from the Daily Mail and the right-wing press just trying to hurt Jeremy Corbyn? Well, I'll tell you one place where there's a real row going on over this, and that is in Tottenham, because former Labour Minister David Lammy is now being threatened by some with deselection by his local party after he attended the rally last night in Parliament Square. Some of the left-wing members of the Tottenham Labour Party claim the MP has, I quote, stabbed them in the back by supporting the Jewish Board of Deputies demo outside Parliament over Labour's alleged failure to deal with anti-Semitism. The row broke out on the Tottenham Labour Party's members-only Facebook group. One said his presence at the demonstration was a sign he is critical of those exercising freedom of speech in criticising Zionism. Another wrote, I want a candidate in the next election who wants Labour to win, not one who joins the extreme right-wing attacks on the Labour movement. He can be triggered, meaning deselected, in December if we hadn't had an election by them. And there are other Labour members, who've criticised the Parliament protest yesterday as being unfair and not necessarily representative of the wider views of the Jewish community. But I tell you what, you know, if MPs like David Lammy are having a punching match with their local constituency, this is a real row. And I don't think, the last caller said that Corbyn's Teflon, none of this ever affects him. Well, Teflon works if the attacks on you simply bounce off and go away. But if they keep on coming week after week, month after month, it makes a difference. I know something about this. Chris is calling me from Richmond. Good evening, Chris.
Nigel, I mean, I feel very strongly that the anti-Semitism in those parties is out of control. Jeremy Corbyn knew exactly what he was doing when you made that comment about the Facebook post last week, and I've seen some just ridiculous comments online about, you know, people didn't know that it was a Jewish people that were...
Just remind people, Chris, you may not be up to speed with this. This was about the mural, wasn't it?
Correct. It was. Yeah.
So this, folks, this...
I also want to make a wider point, Nigel.
Chris, let me just bring the rest of the audience up to speed, because they may not know this. This was a mural up on a wall, and basically it showed elderly Jewish men conspiring and plotting and playing with money and planning the world's future. It was about as anti-Jewish, anti-Semitic a thing as I've ever seen. The mural was going to be removed, and Corbyn posted back in 2012 that it shouldn't be removed. He later said he should have looked at the picture more carefully. Chris, sorry, carry on.
Well, the other, I mean, as I said, the Labour Party's position is disgraceful, but I also want to pick up your recent behaviour. You went to an AFD rally a few months ago, and as you know, the AFD's propaganda was pretty close to, I would say, being Nazi. Comments about an invasion of foreigners. You attended a rally with the, I believe, the granddaughter of Hitler's former finance minister. So, are you really in a position...
Do you know something, Chris? If in Germany, we took out of public life anybody whose parent, grandparent or great-grandparents have been associated with the Nazi movement, there'd be virtually no one left.
That's a deflection tactic, Nigel. That is a
did I? Hang on. No, I'm not deflecting you for a moment, but I'm making a very important point about modern-day Germany. Now, did I appear on a platform supporting an individual candidate? I did. And her name is the Duchess Beatrix von Storck, which would have been a very good name in a sort of British comedy show back in the 70s. Somebody who, Chris, I'd sat with, who'd sat in my group in the European Parliament, who I'd known for 10 years or more, and who I had not for ever one single moment thought was anti-Semitic in any way at all. In fact, if anything, if you were to criticise this candidate that I supported in Berlin, you may say she was perhaps very heavily critical of Islam.
Well, it's not just that, Nigel. I mean, as I said, it's about who you know, it's not just about the one individual candidate, it's the party as a whole. The AFD were putting out some pretty horrific pictures of women in bikinis saying, we don't want your babies. And I mean, I have to say, the fact that you were even associated with that party, I'm sorry, there's a whiff of hypocrisy. Just like there is a whiff of hypocrisy in Conservative MPs tonight, staying silent about some of the comments made on a leaflet in Haybrick. I think all parties and all politicians have to be consistent.
Chris, I've been very careful over the years. I mean, and dealing in European politics is not easy, and I've been careful about who I've worked with and who I haven't worked with. I think I've generally got it far more right than I've got it wrong. I do think there are elements more broadly in the AFD party who perhaps say things about Islam that I certainly would not choose to say, but I've never heard them say anything. I've never heard the party say anything critical of Jewish people because of who they are.
Well, I mean, look, at the end of the day, well, I guess what I'm trying to say is that there was Nazi-type language in some of their propaganda, some of the comments made by, I think, one leader which talked about an invasion of foreigners and all that, and that's echoing Nazism, isn't it?
Well, I think what Mrs. Merkel did was to completely change the whole debate that took place in Europe. But, Chris, your broader point that we've all got to watch out for this is one that I accept. Can I just bring you back to the original question? You know, do you think that Jeremy Corbyn's Labour Party does have a problem with anti-Semitism, or
absolutely.
Is it... You do?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Of course it does. I think it's appalling, and I think the fact that, you know, Labour MPs were getting... I've seen the abuse on Twitter that some people have been receiving. I had a look at Rob, a person's Facebook comment, because I think his family's Jewish, and some of the comments on his Facebook post about the rally on... I think it's just appalling. It's a deflection tactic.
Yeah.
It's all a sort of... You know, on that point, I will agree with you, but as I said, my fundamental point is also that politicians of all colours and all parties need to call out anti-Semitism, racism, even if it hurts their own side. It's really important, and I think at the moment...
Chris, do you know what? As leader of UKIP, I banned anybody who'd ever even been a member of the BNP from joining the party, and I did my absolute best to make it a non-racist, non-sectarian party. Some will think I succeeded, some will think I failed, but I did try and do that. Chris, thank you very much for your point of view. Please would you explain to me why people hate Jews? They seem to be hard-working and family-oriented people, says Marilyn. Again, Corbyn's forced to apologise for the Labour Party's anti-Semitism, but why on earth in the 21st century would anyone in their right minds choose to be associated with and support a bunch of anti-Semites, says Richard. Cos Richard, a lot of people don't believe Jeremy Corbyn is capable of anything nasty at all. They think he's a really, really good guy. It's not just anti-Semitism, I get on text, that is the problem. It's general intolerance. And the big problem is momentum. If you don't agree with their point of view, you've no right to your own, says Chris. Well, whether that's true just of momentum, Chris, generally I think there's been a trend in politics over the last couple of years where if somebody disagrees with you, there's a tendency to shout them down. Not to say you disagree with it, but to say they're not entitled to have that view at all. James is calling me from Cardiff. Good evening, James.
Hello.
Hello there, James. How are you?
Not bad, yourself.
Good. So, is this all something cooked up by the Daily Mail and totally unfair on Corbyn, or is there a real issue here in Britain and perhaps across Europe too?
No, I think that you know, anti-Semitism is big at the moment. The point I wanted to kind of make is that anti-Semitism isn't just sort of a dislike of Jews or not believing what they believe, but it's a treating of Jews as something a bit different, as something that they're kind of like us, but they're not exactly like us. If that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Go on.
With this mural. I think that if that was a mural of any other sort of group, there would be far more condemnation of it. But because it's Jews, I think that Corbyn kind of thought, you know, he's obviously not particularly keen on Israel. He sort of said a lot in sort of protest against Israel. And I think he kind of uses that to justify his overlooking of the treatment of Jews as something a bit different.
But James, the old, you know, the old theory going way back was that it is the Jewish bankers who get together and conspire against the world for their own profit, and that is what that mural depicted, isn't it? I think it was inexcusable, really.
Yeah, I think that was horrific. And I think if you look at cartoons from Germany in the 1930s, and that there's not much difference in it, really.
So, James, given that, you know, I think quite a lot of us think there's a problem here, what should Corbyn do?
I think he needs to realign his views on Israel and what he thinks about the Jewish people, and actually make that clear. You know, there's no problem with having issue with what goes on in Israel and Palestine, but that obviously really affects Corbyn's stance with regards to anti-Semitism.
Well, and clearly, from what I read out a few minutes ago, the Tottenham Labour Party would not particularly want Mr. Corbyn to be nice about Israel. James, there is a big problem. He's got a problem. I thank you very much indeed for your call. And I get on Facebook a message that says, this is a gift to Theresa May. She should call an election and she'd win it. That's what Robert thinks. Mind you, she thought that, didn't she, last year? Didn't quite work out that way. You're listening to The Nigel Farage Show, exclusive in LBC. As Barrow-Inverness Labour MP John Woodcock threatens to resign the whip over the anti-Semitism row in Labour. And, you know, Mr. Corbyn, hundreds of people were outside Parliament last night protesting against you. I'm asking, does the Labour Party have a genuine problem with anti-Semitism, or is this just the Daily Mail punch, 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 trying to really do down a quite popular Labour leader, particularly with many sections of the youth in this country today? But before we get there, a quick word about the Donald. Donald has declared a foreign policy victory after Kim Jong-un's surprise visit to Beijing to discuss North Korea's offer of denuclearization. Trump claimed that Kim's secret visit to Beijing was the result of his pressure on the leader to give up their nuclear weapons. Now, it's worth saying that Kim's father previously made a potential offer to cut back on weapons, not to move on to a nuclear program, and did not stay with that promise or that deal, and the same could happen again. But the fact that Kim Jong-un is there in Beijing, the fact that the President of China and the President of America have spoken today about that visit, the fact there is going to be a meeting of some kind between those two men, it is at least a step very much in the right direction. Well, let me now tell you about something that is not a step in the right direction. The big story of this week that has barely been covered is the fact that senior Catalonian politicians, those that support separation from Spain, those that support independence, and those that are vehemently critical of the European Union, all over Europe this week, people are being arrested, put in prison, are facing trial, and in some cases sentences of up to 30 years in prison for treason and sedition. And you know something? Not one of these Catalan leaders has used violence or has advocated violence, and yet this is how they're being treated. Well, now it's actually on our own doorstep, because a former Catalan minister is now facing extradition to Spain, having handed herself in to the police in Scotland. Clara Ponzati was made the subject of a European arrest warrant last week, and she gave herself up before they found her to a police station in Edinburgh on Wednesday. The former education minister from Catalonia is sought by Madrid on charges of violent rebellion and the misappropriation of public funds. Funny, isn't it? When the big state wants to do you down, it's always misappropriation of public funds. So there we have it. The European arrest warrant being used now on British soil to take this woman, the former education minister from Catalonia, back to Madrid, where she will face trial and a long prison sentence. And do you know something? You won't read a single word about that in tomorrow's newspapers. It's as if no one now cares about Catalonia. Well, they blooming well should. And I tell you what, if anything was a reason to leave the European Union, it's the way Madrid and the European Union are treating people who simply have a different political point of view. I think it's disgusting. Right, back to Corbyn, Labour, anti-Semitism, John Woodcock on the verge of giving up the whip. Does Labour have a problem or not? Jamie is my next caller from Manchester. Good evening, Jamie.
Evening, Nigel. How are you?
I am pleased that we're finally having this debate, because I've seen the growth of this. I've seen the growth of this across much of Europe, particularly on the left, and at least we're now having a conversation about it, Jamie.
No, I would agree. I mean, I've got a very, very simple theory about this whole thing, Nigel, if you'll indulge me for a minute.
Go on, man.
There's two choices here. Number one, which is the scary choice, which is Jeremy Corbyn is an anti-Semite. That is a very, very, very scary thing to think, that the leader of the opposition in this country has a physical hatred of Jewry, British Jewry, international Jewry, whatever you want to call it, the Jewish race. The second option, which is also quite petrifying, is that he is just thick as fudge. That he is, as you know, as the Board of Deputies Chief said, he's standing in a sewer, up to his nose in it, and he hasn't noticed the smell. This is a
well, could I offer you a third option, Jamie?
The pleasure.
Let me offer you a third option. He's picked a side. He's picked a side in an electoral contest, and the side that he's picked is 10 times the size of the other side.
No, absolutely. I mean, I would go along with that. I think it's important as well, if you're going to mention that, to mention, you know, there's a theory, the Red-Green Alliance. I'm sure you've heard of that. Which, you know, the hard left socialists, you know, the Marx, Engels, you know, that kind of trope, who side with, you know, the quite almost violent jihadi aspect of, you know, society. Because, you know, they've used quite rightly, somewhat aligned, you know, the theory of international Jewry controlling money,
Why, Jamie, that's why that mural was so offensive, because it played into all of those old stereotypes, didn't it?
And that leads into my second point, whether he's just a bit sick. If you can look at that and go, I didn't see the anti-Semitism there, you either need to go to Specsavers or you need to give your head a wobble.
Yes, it's ridiculous. There was a cartoon in the Times today, rather the sort of Nelsonian, you know, I see no ships kind of cartoon.
Absolutely.
Jamie, you and I have just discussed the full menu of what it could be with Jeremy Corbyn. What do you think it is?
I, in my heart of hearts, believe he's not an anti-Semite. He's, you know, everyone will trope out, he's got a great anti-racist record, he's got this, his mum was at Cable Street, my dad guarded Princess Diana, doesn't make him part of the royal family, does it? I really hope that he's not an anti-Semite. He's just surrounded by people who have these ideas, and his, you know, he, as you said, he's picked a side.
Yeah.
He's made a decision that he can not ignore, but overlook certain aspects in order to win in the long term.
It's
scary.
I've been critical, Jamie. I have not called Jeremy Corbyn an anti-Semite on this programme. I don't think he's a nasty person, but he has picked a side, and the side that he's picked can be very nasty indeed sometimes. And just look at the way, some of David Lammy's own Labour Party members in Tottenham are talking about him tonight for attending that rally.
No, absolutely. I mean, and as well, the JVL, the Jewish Voice for Labour, which, as a Jew, I could not condone, I hold them in the highest contempt. They to me, remind me of the 1930s, 40s, the Judenrats that the Nazi Party set up in the ghettos to try and remind all the people crowding in there, everything was fine, nothing's going to happen to you. You know, they want us for work, they want us for work. They smack at that. It's ostriches with the head in the sand. Terrible.
Jamie, great call, thank you. I'm going to Israel. For my next call, I'm going to go to Charles. Charles, good evening.
Hi, Charles. It sounds strange when you say it. First of all, I'd like to say good evening to you. We're only 2 hours ahead.
I know.
Number two, I was Charles of Edgware, and now I'm Charles of Netanya.
When did you move to Israel?
Well, a year ago, and I have to tell you, it wasn't just for negative reasons like anti-Semitism, but I wanted to tell you, I've heard a lot of your speeches over the last few years, but before you reach the public consciousness, they made real points. They were neither racist nor sexist, as you were condemned. I suppose I was a middle of the roader, but I always voted for you, Nigel, and the reason I did it...
Very sweet of you, Charles.
Well, you once said that you knew the price, I wonder if you still do, of a pint of milk, and it was a good way to tell politicians.
Yeah.
And I have a lot of friends who are British MPs, and you ask them all, what's the price of a pint of bread, a pint of milk now, or a loaf of bread? And you know, they don't know.
No, they don't know.
So shocked.
Yeah, and I can tell you the price. I could tell you the price of a packet of cigarettes, Charles, but that really would... outrageous!
Well.
Outrageous! I'm going to start rolling my own. Anyway, sorry, Charles.
It's 20% here.
Yeah. What call? To your point.
Yes, to my point. It went like this. One day I was walking, I should say that my grandfather was a bugler in the First World War and survived the Battle of the Somme.
Wow.
I've got an uncle, a late uncle, who won an MBE because he was wounded while a wing commander for the Air Force. And my father was a member of the Royal Signal. So I'm four generations English, and I have to tell you, it was with great sadness that I left, happiness that I was going to Israel. But answering your question from the last caller and taking this forward, do you know what it is? They don't get Jews. Tony Blair got Jews. Mrs. Thatcher got Jews.
She certainly did.
I've met this man once. He doesn't get it. And he doesn't realise that just saying to a Jew, or I was on the Commission for Racial Equality, I was one of the judges on the Media Awards, and when people say, oh, I understand being black, or Woody Allen says in one of his movies, I did 2 years of a three-year black studies course. If I did another year, I'd be black by now. It doesn't work like that.
No.
He's got his head. It's true. He's got his head stuck in a 1960s semi-Marxist-Leninist thing where everybody is equal and all discrimination will be equally dealt with. But what he doesn't realise is the feminist movement proved equal but different. Yes, women have the right to be coal miners, but they're less likely to be coal miners because of the physicality of the job. Jews are, as Dorothy Parker once said, just like anybody else, but more so. And I think, as a loyal Jew, walking to my synagogue one day with my little, he was then 8 years old, he's now 12-year-old son, a gob of phlegm suddenly whizzed past us, and thank God, the man who spat it out and shouted out, effing Jew, this was in Edgware. The police were marvellous. They came immediately. My son remembered his number plate. They told the guy off. They, you know, asked if you want to press charges. They did all of that. 3 months later, my daughter, the same thing. She's wearing a little Star of David. And I said, you know what, darling? So not to you, to my wife.
Yeah.
I said, you know what, darling? I've had it here. I want to go and be where I can be myself, which is a Jew. Now, I've had this discussion
Charles,
with MP.
It really is happening out there, isn't it?
100%. I wasn't the only one.
Yeah.
You should know that I think it's about, I can't remember the exact figure, but it's hundreds and hundreds are leaving per year. In France, it's over...
7,000 a year. 7,000 Jews a year are leaving Greater Paris and moving to Israel and elsewhere.
You see, the reason that we're doing it is because it's very nice. Jean Paul Sartre, who himself was a Marxist, and Marx, as you know, although Jewish, was very anti-Semitic about it. Let me tell you for the record, I've had lunch with Ken Livingstone. I've met a few of these people, and I have to tell you, they're not anti-Semites per se. They would stand up ideologically and say, as Corbyn does, I'm shocked by all of this. But what really shocks you and I is you see the mural, it looks like the Elders of the Protocols of Zion. It's so obvious.
Isn't
which
it?
Part of well done Sherlock don't you get? He has a thing that says, I don't want to make Jews separate or different. I'm not interested. And frankly, as you said, and you know better than most because you're in Europe, and you're even though you don't like it, you're constantly.
I love Europe, Charles. I hate the European Union.
I've heard that speech, and I believe you. You like Europe. I think you like the Europeans. It's the political institutions. What they don't seem to get, it's not about immigration. It's not about colour or race.
Yeah.
It is about stupid things like the Queen being on our currency and the ERB.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Charles, listen. Charles, listen. Great call. Just listen to this, Charles, because given what you've said about your forebears, you'll like this. I got this on text. Your first caller said, Jewish people here should be grateful for the British saving them in the Second World War. Well, what about all the Jewish servicemen who fought in the British Armed Forces during the war, many of whom gave their lives for this country. So, Charles, there you are. The contribution of your forebears has been recognised. Great call there from Israel. Call again. And I tell you what, very interesting. If you go and visit German cemeteries in France, First World War, German cemeteries in France, and you look across the cemetery, you'll see the Jewish crosses of all the Jewish servicemen who died for Germany in World War One. Makes you think a bit, doesn't it? You're listening to the Nigel Farage Show exclusively on LBC. Well, we're discussing anti-Semitism and the Labour Party, and our last caller, Charles, he and his young family have left the country because they found, living in North London, as Jewish people, life has become more difficult. So there is a problem out there. Of that I'm certain. Kathy says, Jeremy likes all countries and people except his own British people. He has absolutely no respect for any of us and would lead us down the wrong path at every turn he could. Him, Prime Minister, don't make me laugh. Well, you never know. Morris says on Facebook, oh, this is charming. Nigel, keep your nose out of Spain's woes and help sort out the mess of Brexit you've helped make. Well, tomorrow, Morris, 1 year to go. 1 year to liberation, to independence, to what we voted for, at least I hope so. And as for keeping my nose out of Spain's woes, yeah, you're quite right, Morris. I tell you what, as they're imprisoning, you know, elected people and former ministers, let's say nothing. When they start hanging a few, let's say nothing. Let's just pretend none of it's happening, because we need to maintain, Morris, the integrity of the European project. Let's all say nothing. Thank you, Morris. Do come again. And while we're talking about my friends in Brussels, now you'll love this. In fact, there'll be conspiracy theories about what I'm about to tell you. Because today, the European Commission has pledged to push for upgrades in road and rail infrastructure under an action plan to get European Union countries to cooperate on shifting troops and military hardware around the bloc. That's right. They want roads and railways to be in better shape to move tanks and rockets around Europe. Do you believe me, Mr. Clegg, when I said 4 years ago to you in that LBC debate, they're building a European army, and you said it was a dangerous fantasy? Do you believe me now? It's happening. Back to the callers. Judith is calling from Yeovil in Somerset. Good evening, Judith.
Hello there, Nigel. Can I begin by saying that even though I have a Hebrew name, I am not Jewish. I'm a confirmed member of the Anglican Church, as were my parents before me. But it's outrageous that I feel the need to have to justify myself. And I found Charles's call terribly, terribly sad.
Yes.
That this is happening in our country today.
Well, Judith, I do you know what? I didn't disbelieve a word that Charles said, did you?
Neither did I, no. Neither did I. Because people do these things, and it doesn't surprise me in the slightest. But to get back to your topic today about Jeremy Corbyn, he's either stupid or he's a liar. Either way, he is not capable of taking my dog for a walk. I wouldn't allow him let loose on my dog, let alone lead a party.
Well,
it's outrageous.
But the point is, Judith, he is leading a party, isn't he?
I know, and he needs to be got rid of. Because nobody with a grain of humanity or a grain of decency would vote for a man like that.
Do you believe, Judith, that he is an anti-Semite himself, or that he's rather conveniently turned a blind eye to it within the Labour movement?
Both. And
do
as
you?
Regards the former, is he an anti-Semite himself? As my father used to say, if he was alive, God bless him, You are judged by the company you keep.
Okay, so Hamas and Hezbollah would not put him in a very good place, would they? Judith, thank you very much indeed for your call. Nadia says to me on Twitter, Jeremy Corbyn is not and never has been a racist towards anyone. The Tories are the racists. I have the misfortune to be in their company too often. Every one of them I have met are blatantly so and proud of themselves. Well, Nadia, we're not discussing whether the Tory party are full of racists or not, but we are discussing the fact that hundreds of Jewish people were there in Parliament Square with their placards saying enough is enough. And just to run away and say the other lot are worse doesn't really help. Nigel, what do you mean Corbyn is a nice fellow? I don't trust him. I think you're a much nicer person than him. I don't trust Corbyn to run anything, let alone the country, says Kay. I don't think... that Jeremy Corbyn, I don't personally think Jeremy Corbyn harbours deep personal resentment against Jewish people. I believe, as I've said already, he has picked a side. And he's picked a side that electorally he thinks will bring him advantage. That's how I see it. Luke is calling from Orpington. Good evening, Luke.
Good evening again. Yes, I don't think we should patronise Jeremy Corbyn, and I think that we should admit the fact that he's actually more intelligent than we think, and he knows exactly what he's doing.
Yep.
He's chosen a group. I mean, goodness, he's a politician. He should be quite up there with knowing what he's doing, who he's hanging out with. We need to also remember those people who stood outside Parliament. Now, I'm not a Jew, I'm a Christian, but I'd like to say that if I was off work, then I would have had the opportunity to stand there as well with them and unite with them, because Jews, Christians, we're very close, we love them. And as far as I'm concerned, you know, Benjamin Disraeli, he was a prime minister, don't forget.
Yeah.
Of course, you know, we have a long history together, Great Britain, and I loved actually John the Break. There's a song called Jerusalem, isn't there?
There certainly is. Absolutely, Luke. So, Luke, he's picked a side. You agree with me. I thank you for your call. And look, we've seen lots of it. A lot of it's to do with Palestine. People who take the pro-Palestinian and the anti-Israel position. Peter is calling from Southend-on-Sea, and he's my last caller this evening on this subject. Good evening, Peter.
Good evening to you, Nigel. Thanks for taking my call. Just on the debate generally, it's clear that the Labour left, headed by Jeremy, do have a problem with anti-Semitism. However, they couch it under being... You don't have to be an anti-Semite if you disagree with Israel's policies, or you disagree with Zionism, or you are indeed very friendly towards Israel's enemies like Hamas and Hezbollah. But you know what, Nigel? If you're all those things... then there's a my dad was a bookmaker, and you've got, he wouldn't give you long odds on being an anti-Semite as well within those categories. But I tell you what is interesting, Nigel, something that you mentioned very earlier on about David Lammy, who is a fantastic MP for North London, a very, very sincere gentleman. I've had the pleasure to meet him on a couple of occasions. Now, what I think this is going to expose is the your last caller said you're judged by the company you keep.
Yep.
And Jeremy Corbyn was always with the most racist Muslim elements, such as Hezbollah and Hamas, and all those very extreme...
Well, that's your judgment, Peter. Peter, are you a Labour Party supporter?
Not at all, sir.
Not at all.
I'm not a Labour Party supporter, but I'm a moderate voter. That's what I would say. But I think that the black community, headed by David Lammy now, will begin to understand the hatred that the most extreme elements of the Muslim political groups, such as Hamas and Hezbollah, feel towards them. And actually, by the momentum group calling out David.
Okay, well, Peter,
be a very good thing.
I've got to leave you there. I thank you very much for your call and your passion. You've been listening to the Nigel Farage Show.